Bonnie and I have been blessed for a few to be able to go to the city of London a few times in our life, and we've enjoyed it greatly. If you've ever been there, you might have noticed there's this huge ancient obelisk there called Cleopatra's Needle. It's just off the tube stop at near Embankment. It's about a 3-wood shot from St. James Park, so you can probably find it that way. But Cleopatra's Needle is it's a foreigner, and it stands out in London. Her engravings speak of a different era, a completely different language. And workers constructed this obelisk 3,500 years ago as a gift for an Egyptian pharaoh. Think about how long ago that was. But in 1878, the British government decided to plant it on English soil, right on the banks of the River Thames. Now, it's a giant granite column, and it's smothered with ancient hieroglyphics. And this structure once stood in front of the great temple at Heliopolis. Pharaohs used to pass in front of this thing in their chariots. Think about that. And now Cleopatra's Needle stands on a British waterway with a British time capsule buried in its base. Someday, they figured, when Britain goes the way of ancient Egypt, excavators might dig it up, find the box, and find a slice of Victorian England. Because in that box, they'll find a set of coins, a city directory of the City of London, 12 photos of what they deemed to be the most beautiful women of their day, and there was a razor. And I was trying to figure out why they put a razor in there next to the women's picture. Seems kind of random. Maybe it's this desperate hope that women in the future would shave their legs. I can't prove that. But there's something else that's found in that capsule. There's a verse from the Bible, translated into 215 different languages. Which verse? John 3:16. God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So picture some future Londoner digging through the rocks and rubble in some post-apocalyptic time. Just imagine that. And he or she finds this, digs it up, and then reads the verse. And except for one word in that verse, they might dismiss it as ancient religious myth. Which word? Whoever. Whoever. That word, whoever, unrolls the welcome mat of heaven to humanity. That word, whoever, it destroys racial fences. It destroys social classes. It bypasses gender and ancient traditions of every kind. Whoever makes it clear, God exports his grace worldwide. Worldwide. For those who attempt to restrict that grace, Jesus has a word for them, and it is whoever. Say that word with me. Whoever. And before we think that's just one word pulled out of context, let's just take a quick look at how many times God reinforces this principle in the rest of his word. I'm just going to go through them real quickly. Matthew 10, whoever acknowledges me before men, I will also acknowledge him before my Father in heaven. Matthew 10 also says, whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. Mark chapter 3, whoever does God's will is my brother and sister. Mark 16, whoever believes and is baptized will be saved. John 3, whoever believes in the Son Jesus has eternal life. John 4, whoever drinks the water I give him will never thirst. John 11, whoever lives and believes in me will never die. Revelation 22, whoever is thirsty, let him come. And whoever wishes, let him take the free gift of the water of life. Later on in Titus 2:11, Paul writes these words. He assures us that the grace of God has appeared to all men, to all people. So, whoever does not contradict the message of the Bible, it is the message of the Bible. The gospel has a whoever policy, and that also tells us something else. It tells us that whoever also kind of means however. Think about this. There's this misunderstanding amongst people worldwide that heaven is reserved for the religious, for the monks, for the goody-goodies, for the spiritual overachievers, those that will happily point out the sins of others. Nothing could be further from the truth. Listen to this statement. The only thing that we contribute to our salvation is the sin that makes it necessary. That should be humbling. Should be. We depend entirely on the strength of our good Father and the sacrifice of Jesus. That's it. We can't point to some area of life in which we think we're doing pretty good and expect that God would give us some special credit there while we're morally bankrupt when it comes to real righteousness. That's just a clean miss if you think that way. It doesn't work that way. It reminds me of the mechanic who said to the car owner, "I couldn't fix your brakes, so I made your horn louder." Doesn't work that way. The Apostle Paul also had this jolting revelation from God. He had spent a lifetime trying to save himself. Then he comes to this Damascus Road experience. Jesus appeared to him. And once Paul saw Jesus, he could no longer see the value in his own resume. And he couldn't see any other option except to spend the rest of his life talking less about himself and more about Jesus. He became the poet of grace. In the book of Philippians, chapter 3, he writes this: "All these things that I once thought very worthwhile, now I've thrown them all away so I can put my trust and hope in Christ alone." Alone. Jesus says, "Whoever believes, whoever comes to me," and "whoever" means however. Not just the monks, even the least likely are included. In Romans chapter 4, he writes this: "To the one who does not work but believes in him who justifies the ungodly, his faith is credited as righteousness." So Paul assures salvation to the most unlikely folks, not to the worker, but to the truster, not to the able-bodied, but to the unable, not to the affluent, but to the bankrupt, to the child who will trust with complete reliance upon his heavenly Father. The Message version of that verse I just read, Romans 4:5, says this: "Trusting him to do it is what gets you set right with God, by God, sheer gift." Sheer gift. So God takes starting line to finish line responsibility for his children. That's, you know, when we believe, what we're really doing is riding his strength, not our own. That's how we get right with God. So whoever means however. We need to remember that, because the downturns of life can sometimes leave us in such a sad state of affairs that we feel like we're dying a little bit every day. And we wonder if God still wants us. He does. He does. Whoever means however. But whoever also features a whenever clause. Whenever. Whoever also means whenever. You ever run across a gift certificate that was expired? I've done this. Go through the drawer of my desk and find a Bennigan's gift card from 1998. What you do with that says a lot about you. I mean, some of you look at that and go, "Oh, ridiculous," and you pitch it. But some of you are like me, and we don't give up so easily, do we? We'll make the phone call. "Hello, I've got a slightly expired gift certificate for your restaurant. You'll still honor it, won't you?" "Oh, you're not a restaurant anymore, okay? What are you?" "Pet grooming." "Okay, can I come in and get a haircut?" We just don't give up that easily. Truth is, most times when you let something expire, you're just out of luck. That's how they make money. Morons like me who forget they had the card. It's a tough lesson. The invitation expired. I waited too long, and now I lose out. But you know what? With God, it is not too late. It's not too late. Even if you think you've waited too long, you haven't. And to convince you, Jesus wove a parable of 11th hour grace. He described a landowner who needed helpers out in his land, just like a farmer might hire migrant workers or a landscaper hires temps to fill out his crew. This guy employed some workers for him. In Matthew chapter 20, Jesus says he agreed to pay the normal wage and sent them out to work. And the story that mentions that a few of them were hired early. That's normal. You get a full day's work out of them. Then he went back and hired some more at 9 a.m. Went back, brought some more in at noon. Surprisingly, goes back out at 3 o'clock and brings more workers in. And then unbelievably, at 5 p.m., 1 hour before Miller time, he goes out and gets another group of people to come in and work. 1 hour remaining in the workday. Those workers expected to go home with empty pockets, didn't they? I mean, no landlord issues a final hour invitation, do they? God does. No one pays a full day's wage to a one-hour worker, do they? God does. And Jesus' punchline comes in verse 9 here. He says, "Each one received full day's wage." They got paid full. So What does that mean? Deathbed converts and lifelong saints enter by the same gate. Jesus. What does that mean to us? Well, it could be that you've never really thought of yourself as a religious person. That's actually good. Religion often gets in the way. You don't have to be religious to get right with God. Jesus came to fling open the door to heaven to everyone, not just those steeped in religion. Matter of fact, some of the harshest words of Jesus were reserved for those that used religion to make people feel like they weren't welcome before God. So the good news is, even if you feel like you've lived a life so far that has not been a very spiritual person, that can all change today. God already knows about your confidential failure files. He knows that already. Yet he still invites you to come and be with him. Because God's invitation to you is not for yesterday, it's for today. You can't undo the stuff from yesterday. We all wish there was some stuff we could do over. But God's invitation is not about yesterday. God's about today and tomorrow. He wants you to be with him, forgiven, cleansed once and for all, accepted and filled with life and with hope. With God, it is not too late. Whoever means whenever. But there's another truth hidden in here as well, and it's this. Whoever also means wherever. Wherever you are, you're not too far to come home. In Luke chapter 15, Jesus tells a story that we know as the lost son or the prodigal son. This son demanded the inheritance that he would one day receive, but he wanted it now. He wanted it now. And he treated his father with utter disregard, and he acted out his selfish sense of entitlement. The Bible tells us that he spurned his father's kindness, took the money, ran, and in verse 13 it says, he journeyed to a far country, and there wasted his possessions with wild living. I can imagine this spoiled son tossing his father's money around to this merchant and that merchant and that merchant, roll of bills at one club, another roll of bills at another. He rides the magic carpet of cash from party to party to party. And it's pretty fun. Maybe not quite as great as he thought it would be, but still pretty cool being the center of attention. When you're flinging money around, you're the center of attention. Then the day comes where his wallet grows thin and his credit card gets sent back to him declined. The maitre d' says no. Hotel manager says go. And the prodigal son says, uh-oh. His whole world changes. He's used to now living in a flurry of nothing but the best, but now he's experiencing nothing but the worst. When his money disappeared, so did his fair weather friends. Turns out they weren't as tight as he thought they were. Turns out he's not their boy when he's not buying drinks. You know, you can always find somebody to tip a few back with you, but nobody really wants to hear much about your problems. So this freshly broke prodigal son finds himself alone for the very first time. He never saw it coming. He says, this is what happens to other people. It's not what happens to me. So he slides from living high on the hog to feeding pigs in the mud. It got so bad, this is the only employment he can find, feeding pigs for chump change. Not a recommended career path for a Jewish boy. So the hunger gnaws at his gut so badly that he entertains eating the pig's food alongside them. That's how desperate and bad it's gotten. But then, rather than swallow the pods, he instead chooses to swallow his pride, and he begins that famous walk homeward, rehearsing his repentance speech with every step along the way. But you know what? It turns out that he didn't even need it. Didn't need that speech. Why? Because his loving father had never given up hope that he would return. Despite the pain that he caused this loving father, this rebellious, ungrateful son. But still, the love of the father is too great to just give up and unplug him for life. Verse 20, here's what it says. When he was still a long way off, his father saw him. His heart pounding, he ran out and embraced him. Father was saving the son's place. He's saving yours too. If heaven's table, banquet table has got nameplates, yours, you got one of them. And you know, all of us, we lose in life sometimes. We lose prosperity. We lose sobriety. We lose dignity. We lose youthful zeal. We lose at love sometimes. But you know what? We never, ever lose our place with God. No status too low. No hour too late. No place too far. However, whenever, wherever, and forever. Forever. You think, forever? Really? Well, what if I mess up? I don't have a good track record. Is he going to ditch me when he finds out what a mess I am? Well, look what Jesus says in Luke, John 10:28. He says, I give them eternal life, and they shall never lose it or perish throughout the ages, and no one is able to snatch them out of my hand. Now, we parents, we understand God's resolve. When our children stumble, we don't disown them. When they fall, we may punish, we may reprimand or something, but cast them out of the family? No way. No way. They're biologically connected to us. Those born with our DNA will die with it. Now, God, our Father, cultivates the very same relationship with us. When we surrender to Jesus, John chapter 1 says, we become children of God. He alters our lineage. He redefines our spiritual parenthood, and in doing so, he secures our salvation. Religious effort provides no promise, no promise at all. Only Jesus guarantees a safe landing. Only Jesus. Now, just for a moment, contrast the offer of Jesus with the offer of other religions. And they're not knocks on the other religions. They're just statements that each of these belief systems make for themselves. Judaism sees salvation as a judgment day decision based on your morality. Hindus anticipate multiple reincarnations in the soul's journey through the cosmos. Buddhism grades your life according to the Four Noble Truths, according to the Eightfold Path. Muslims earn their way to Allah by performing the duties of the five pillars of faith. Even many atheist or worldly philosophers, they deem life after the grave as hidden and unknown. No one but Jesus secures you. And that's why we believe in him. Don't believe in you. You can't save you. Don't believe in others. They can't save you. John 14:6, Jesus says these words, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Jesus could have scored some more points in political correctness if he said, I know a way or I show a way. But he didn't say that, did he? He said, I am the way. I am the way. He alone conquered death by rising from the tomb on Easter morning. This is what we're celebrating today. This is what we're celebrating. Although lots of people have relegated it to jelly beans and colored eggs and an overpriced brunch, this is actually the pivotal day of hope for all humanity, all of us. Death was defeated. Life is now offered to us eternally. But here's the challenge. Here's the challenge in our day. Our world is shrinking. Cultures are blending. Borders are bending. This is the day of inclusion. All roads lead to heaven. That's what makes you friends on social media. All roads lead to heaven. It's all good. But can all roads really lead to heaven? I mean, that notion makes good talk show fodder, but is it accurate? Can all approaches to God be correct? Can they? Every non-Christian religion says, you can save you. Jesus says, my death on the cross and resurrection from the grave is what saves you. So, how can all religions lead to God when they are all so wildly different? We don't tolerate that crazy logic in other areas of life. We just don't. We don't pretend that all roads lead to Boise or all ships sail to Hong Kong. We don't. All flights don't land in Chicago. Imagine an exchange with a travel agent who insists that that is the case. You tell him you need a flight to Chicago, and so he looks on his computer screen and says, okay, there's a flight to LA departing at 6 a.m. He said, well, does it go to Chicago? Oh, no, but the in-flight snacks and movies are wonderful. But I need to go to Chicago. Well, then let me suggest our local SunRail commuter train. Our local SunRail goes to Chicago? No, but they win awards for on-time arrivals. Now you're starting to get a little bit ticked. You say, I need one airline to carry me to one place, Chicago. And the agent gets all offended. Says, I believe all paths lead to Chicago. We know better. You know better. Different flights have different destinations. That's not a stubborn conclusion, it's an honest one. Every flight does not go to Chicago. Every path does not lead to God. Jesus blazed a standalone trail void of self-salvation. He is the one-of-a-kind passageway to God, not human effort. Christ came not for the strong, but for the weak, not for the righteous, but for the sinners. He offers a unique invitation in which he works and we trust. He dies and we live. He invites and we believe. We believe in him. Here's a great verse in John chapter 6. The work God wants you to do is this. Believe the one he sent. Believe the one he sent. Believe in yourself? No. Believe in him. And those who do, those who put their trust in him, there is this incredible promise that we read earlier. They shall not perish, but have eternal life. Eternal life. So, how do we start? How does this all begin? We turn to our Father for help. We turn our eyes toward God. The summary of John 3:16 that we read at the beginning of this message, the summary of that verse is this. God loves. God gives. We believe. We live. Say that with me. God loves. God gives. We believe. And we live. This is the message of Easter. Jesus Christ died to make forgiveness possible. But he rose and defeated death so that we could share in his victory forever. He's alive. He's alive forever. And we can be too. We just simply take our faith and our trust and place it in Christ for our salvation and not in our own self, not in our own goodness, not in our own effort, recognizing that what he did is what matters, not what you do so much. We place our trust in him. When you do that, you're his forever. Just like he's alive forever, you're his forever. That's the best news that anybody could ever, ever get. But it's up to us. It's up to you to receive it. So why not make today, Easter Sunday, the day that you took that oh so rewarding step of faith? It is the best step I ever took. And a lot of you would say the same.